What if I told you that trees can talk? That beneath the soil, their roots are whispering, sharing nutrients, even warning each other of danger. Today, I'll show you how to repot big bonsai, even if you're working alone. And along the way, we'll uncover the hidden science of roots and how trees might just be smarter than we think. Trust me, this is not just another bonsai tutorial. This is a tree that we're going to repot today. Taxus baccata, or English yew. A kama is used to release the roots from the side of the container. It's important to use very, very gentle strokes and not to saw into the soil because that will be detrimental to the roots. Repotting alone is not always easy. This is why I'm going to use my shoulder against the tree, then squeeze in order to anchor the tree against the shoulder. And I'll remove the pot, put it aside, balance the tree, and we're done. My first priority is always to uncover the nabari first. This will give me a better picture of what I need to do with the rest of the roots. In order to achieve this, I use bamboo chopstick and also a root rake. Be very careful with root rakes because they tear a lot. So I will be using the chopstick a lot more than the root rake. Root rake is only when you have like these long extended roots that you're gonna cut away anyways. It's just a lot easier and faster, but for more detailed or bits that I'm going to use, I'm really going to try to use the chopsticks a lot more. It has been hypothesized that white root tips such as this one are the brains of the tree. Although these might not be from Taxus baccata, it could also mean that it's a weed. We are going to investigate this a little bit further though, in order to not get rid of those root tips because they are very important. Just as we expected, it was just a weed. This is good news because if there are a lot of white growing tips on your tree, then it's best not to repot because you would do a lot of harm, and we do not want this, especially because we are doing open heart surgery on a tree right now. My main objective for now is to identify pockets of field soil just like this one. These are easy to distinguish due to the fact that they are blackish in color, and you can see that there are not as many roots growing inside of these pockets, which is in of itself an indication of the detrimental effect it has on the root system. Most people think of trees as these silent, solitary beings, but they're actually a part of a secret underground society. Through their roots, trees are connected to a massive fungal network, which scientists call the wood wide web. Think of it like nature's internet. Trees use it to send distress signals when they're under attack, and even share nutrients with weaker trees. It's not as much about just survival, but more about cooperation. A forest isn't just a collection of trees, it's a community. Much like Bonsai Lab will become my hope. When I see obvious cuts such as this root above the other, where you know that it's safe to remove it, then I'm just gonna do it. It saves me time, I don't have to look for it again. I know it's safe, so let's just do it. Back in the 1800s, Charles Darwin suggested that the root tip of a plant might actually work like a brain. Roots don't just absorb water, they sense gravity, obstacles, even other plants. Some scientists believe that the trees might have a kind of underground intelligence where roots process information and make decisions. Of course, not everyone agrees. Some researchers say that there is no solid proof that trees think the way we do. But one thing is clear. Trees sense the world in ways that we're only beginning to understand. So next time you walk past a tree, remember, it's not just standing there. Underground, it's alive in ways we never imagined. In the meanwhile, I've identified another clay pocket. Look at how the particles stick together. Let me just explain why this is actually so detrimental for your tree. This is clay under an electron microscope. See how the particles are like tiny flat plates stacked on top of each other. There's no space in between for air, no room for oxygen to reach the roots. That means that Clay doesn't just hold water, it drowns your plant. Roots need oxygen to breathe. Without it, they'll suffocate, resulting into dead roots such as this one. You identify them by the dark color, and if you open them up, they're all mushy inside and hold a lot of moisture. This is not how a root should look. Let's take a look at how a root normally looks. Let me just take this one, scratch it open a little bit. This has a lovely red color, well, at least Taxus baccata is red, but you will see a difference. It has a lively color inside, it's not filled with water, and it's not mushy, it's strong. That's why bonsai soil is different, open, well-draining, full of oxygen pathways. This is what keeps roots healthy and strong. While removing as much as possible field soil that remained inside the root ball, I'm also going to try to preserve everything that has good bonsai soil in it already. When repotting trees, it's always important to leave portions untouched. First, it will not stress the tree as much, and second, you will keep your microbiology that is in that portion completely intact, meaning that you won't touch the hardware of your wood white web as much, if you will. This is a structural root that I might end up using in the final product, or at least I'm going to use it later on to anchor the tree to the pot. This is concrete evidence that roots do not grow in field soil, at least not in a bonsai pot. During the entire repotting process, I always keep a spray can filled with water near me so I can moisten the roots. It's important to not let them dry out because this could also be detrimental to them. This entire portion of the root ball has been left unharmed or untouched for the same reason that I already mentioned before. This will be refilled with good bonsai soil, as well as this part here. I'm completely sure that because I left so much untouched, that the tree will not only survive, but it will thrive. Now I can work on the ramification of the wood ball, if you will. I'm going to cut off the tips in order to create more ramification. I'm going to look for roots that are growing in funny directions or where I can improve taper, just like this one. This one is growing in a funny direction and I have roots that can improve the taper. So it's a double whammy. Here is another clear example of where I have to cut in order to improve not only the direction of the roots, but also the taper. This one is growing upwards. We do not want our roots to grow upwards. We want our roots to grow in a radial pattern and slightly downwards into the soil. I have been waiting for an entire year to use this container, so I'm really, really happy right now that I'm going to use it finally. I will be putting the Taxus in a 1:1:1 pumice akadama lava mixture. But first, let's prepare the pot. I'll be using drainage screens in order to keep the soil inside the pot and to not create extra air holes, because we do not want that. I will be using aluminum wire and the butterfly technique, where I just twist the ends into two loops. You can see one is going upwards and the other one is going downwards, and then I bend the wires or the ends of the wires upwards so that I will be able to insert this through the mesh, through the drainage screens, and the ends of the wire will be the anchor to the pot. I want my warp to be really clean, so I'm just going to twist the wires in the direction of the pot, cut it so it's nice and crisp, and then we're able to go to the next step, which is preparing the wires to anchor the tree. I will be using 3 millimeters of aluminum wire, although this is perfectly possible with stainless steel wire. I just have this at hand, so I'm going to use that. It's important to really measure the holes, because if you do not measure the length between the two holes that you're going to use, then you will have excess wire and your wires won't have a snug fit. You really want a snug fit in order to be able to crank the wires and make sure that your tree is really, really tightly in the pot. Also, make sure you bend your wire with gym pliers. This will make a very clean angle, which will rest perfectly in your drainage holes, which will reduce excess wire even further. I will be using 3 points of anchoring with the tree in order to stabilize it into the pot. Our first layer is called the oxygen layer. This makes sure that oxygen exchange will occur. This is slightly coarser soil. Then I fill the pot with a smaller sized particle. This all depends on how big your tree is. If you have a Shohin tree, of course, you're going to use really small particles, and the larger your tree, the larger your particles. Well, to a certain extent, of course. I am filling the pot with a cone. This cone will help me stabilize the tree in order to first look for my planting angle of the tree. And then secondly, when I wiggle it in, this mount will disperse and it will anchor itself in the root ball. More specifically, the places that I cannot reach with my chopsticks. This looks like a good angle, although it's way too high in the pot, so I will have to reshape my cone and make it a little bit lower. While wiggling the tree in the pot, I'm very cognizant of the angle that I want it, and I try to lock the pot in between my legs while I rock the tree, well, not rock, but slide the tree backwards and forwards, keeping the same angle. This is key, because if you keep the same angle, the mount will shape itself like the angle, and also make sure that it doesn't tip too much forward or backwards while doing this. As you can probably see, I am exerting quite a lot of force on the pot and on the tree. Nevertheless, I am keeping the same angle. Because I'm still growing this tree, I'm going to grow the apex towards me. So I don't mind pushing it backwards a little bit in order to create more movement so that the tree goes backwards and comes back to the front. Today I'm lucky to identify solid anchor points. This will make the anchoring of the tree a lot easier. If you do not have these, it's possible to just take bamboo sticks and hit them inside the root ball and use that as anchorage. I make sure that I pull my wires and then twist, and I also make sure that I tighten one spot and then I go to the next, I tighten that up and go to the next and tighten that up, but not all at once. I revisit every spot just in order to make sure that my tree doesn't start leaning to one side or the other. Although I'm definitely not there yet, I am systematically getting closer and closer to the Nabari that I'm going to use in the end. This will take me a few more repots. As I already mentioned, Bonsai is a marathon and not a sprint. After trying to fill the entire pot with soil, it's time for chopsticking. This is one of the most important parts of repotting. You do not want any air holes. I am using a bamboo chopstick, which means that one side is actually softer than the other. As you can see here, it is also cut to an angle in order to push the soil into the air pockets that still remain. These are detrimental because too much air also means too much water, and too much water, well, we're back at the clay again. You will drown your plants, and we want a perfect balance of water and oxygen inside of the container, which will ensure a healthy bonsai. And that's eventually the end goal. I start chopsticking from the inside, or the point closest to the root ball or to the tree, and I start moving myself outwards, making sure that there are no air pockets. When there is no more air pockets left, that's when the soil will stop moving inwards and it will stop falling down into the pot. That's when you know you're finished. Then one final sweep and we're done. Now that I changed the angle of the tree slightly, I will need to consider bending down this branch. Right now it has an unsightly arc, and I want the angle to be a lot more acute, but I will not be doing this right now. I'm going to wait until either fall or next spring. And just like that, our bonsai has a fresh start. No more suffocation, no more drowning, just oxygen space and room to grow. Now, all what's left is patience, because just like trees, good things take time. If you found this helpful, let me know in the comments, and if you want to keep learning, you know what to do.